Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this service of worship, and we will be celebrating communion virtually this morning. So I trust that many of you have already prepared the elements, and may we experience God's love in a very special way this morning when we reach out to a piece of bread and a cup of wine or a cup of grape juice. May God bless us in being together this morning. I would like to welcome Brian doing the recording for us, John playing the piano, and then you saw the four ladies that rang the bells for us. It's Anne and Karen, Shannon and Carrie. Thank you so much for bringing your gift to our service of worship this morning. And Carrie and Shannon will also sing our hymns this morning. Dear family and friends, let's call on God in worship. Sing a new song to the Lord. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Proclaim his salvation day by day. Share his glory among the nations. Amen. Dear family and friends, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our hymn of praise this morning is hymn 467. Let's join together in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we are gathered here this morning to offer you praise. We come yielding our hearts, our minds, our very lives to you, for you alone are worthy to receive glory and honor. You created all things, and by your will everything exists. Today we joyfully remember your faithfulness, compassion, and love when we celebrate communion together. All we are,
all we need, all we enjoy, and all we can become is a God-given gift. Lord, we wait on you. Send your Spirit to enlighten us as we listen to your word
and reach out to bread and wine today. Amen. One of the suggested lectionary readings for this Sunday comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13, through to chapter 5, verse 1. But we continue to preach because we have the same kind of faith the psalmist had when he said, "I believe in God, so I spoke." We know that God who raised the Lord Jesus will also raise us with Jesus and present us to himself together with you. All of this is for your benefit. And as God's grace reaches more and more people, there will be great thanksgiving, and God will receive more and more glory. That is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on the things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. For we know that when this earthly tent we live in is taken down, that is, when we die and leave this earthly body, we will have a house in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God himself and not by human hands. I have read that many years ago at the Hayden Planetarium in New York City, they posted some advertisements in many newspapers asking people that would like to be the first to go to a different planet to sign up. And in a few days, 18,000 people signed up. These sign-up sheets were given to a panel of psychologists. And these psychologists went through these sign-up sheets and came to the conclusion that a very large percentage of people that wanted to go to a different planet did so because they felt to go to a different planet would be better because they were so discouraged with the one on which they find themselves. Now, in our reading this morning, Paul used the word trouble or troubles twice in verse 17 and 18. And the Greek word for trouble is a word that we can also translate with pressure, things that weigh us down, pressures that squeezes the joy and the peace, the hope and the light out of us. I'm not exactly sure if we have a full understanding of the implications of this COVID pandemic in the lives of people. So much has changed for people. So many people have lost their lives and their livelihoods. Many people suffer because of anxiety, and many people also suffer physically. There are hundreds of people that also lost loved ones during this pandemic. And the sad part is that they couldn't celebrate the lives of their loved ones in the same way as we could pre-COVID, because many a time, most of the funerals could only be done with 5 to 25 people in attendance, depending on the government orders. I myself has lost my father in August of 2020, and I haven't been able to go back to South Africa yet. To celebrate his life with my now widowed mother, my three sisters, and my family in South Africa. Being unable for us to gather in the same way as we were able to do pre-COVID means that we didn't have the opportunity to face one another and other people and family and friends, and to look into one another's eyes and to remind one another that despite our vulnerability, our own mortality as human beings, that our lives that sometimes waste away and eventually we die, that in the light of all of this, our scripture reading this morning says that our souls are being renewed day by day, verse 16. Despite trouble, we could then, if we were able to meet together in person, like in the pre-COVID times, we could remind one another of verse 17. These troubles won't last forever. And we also cannot look one another in the eye when we deal with a lot of difficulties and encourage one another and say that when this earthly tent of ours are broken down, we have a house in heaven, an eternal house with God. Chapter 5, verse 1. In our reading this morning, Paul wants to remind us as Christians that trouble and discouragement and suffering actually also accomplishes something in our lives. And what it accomplishes in our lives is that God can use many of these troubles and discouragements and suffering in such a way that it also brings hope to others dealing with similar situations. And this is how Paul looks at his life and his troubles. And when you study Paul's life, you become aware of the fact that Paul didn't always have it easy. In the first 12 verses of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, you will see in verse 2 and verse 3 and verse 5 that there was some people dissatisfied with Paul's ministry. There was some gossip going on about Paul. Some people accused him and said, "You're not really an apostle." The other gossip morsel was, Paul is just doing this for himself. Paul is using deceitful methods in his ministry. And if you have time today, just page to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 to 28, and you will see the other stuff that Paul suffered and dealt with, things that made him discouraged in life. And I think if we were in his shoes, it would mean the same for us. Paul was imprisoned because he shared the good news message. Paul was whipped. He was beaten, so much so that he faced these trials in such a way that he felt death is awaiting him time and time again. Paul was shipwrecked. He spent a day and a night on the open sea. Paul had all kinds of troubles and dangers with crossing rivers and dangers in the cities, dangers from people that said that they were Christians but not, dangers from his own people, dangers from the Gentiles. Paul also experienced what it means to be hungry and to be thirsty and not to have enough to eat. He many a time had to shiver in a cold night because he didn't have enough clothes to wear. And then on top of all of this, Paul also had the emotional burden that he carried for all the congregations, the new congregations, giving these first steps in their life with Christ in a very hostile world. And despite all of this, Paul was able to continue with his ministry and to continue with his life. Why? Because Paul believed what the psalmist believed. I believe in God, and so I speak. Verse 13 of our reading this morning. Paul says, we as Christians never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. Verse 16. And dear friends, it is easy for us to say these words and to try and encourage others with these words. Don't give up when everything is going well. It's when the troubles in our lives start mounting and we have to practice this very important spiritual principle that it becomes much more difficult. And that's when we sometimes feel we just need to leave. If it's possible just to go to another planet and start over, that would actually work best. We as Christians must remember that our brokenness is something that God can also use to share his grace with others. And this is part of the wonderful privilege of being part of a church family, being part of a congregation. Because as we come to know each other better, we also realize that our fellow brothers and sisters in a congregation are not perfect. All of us experience, or at some point experience, troubles, discouragement, pain, and suffering. And we live life together many a time as broken people, and we can also build our lives in our brokenness on what Paul said, because Paul was no different than us. What Paul said in verse 17 and 18. And I would like to read that to you again. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long, yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see. Rather, we fix our gaze on the things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. Paul shares with us in these two verses that there is another weight that outweighs our trouble, our discouragement, and our suffering and pain. And the weight that outweighs these is the weight of the glory of God and eternity, eternal life. And when we experience the weight of God's glory and the weight of eternity and eternal life in Christ Jesus, the weight of troubles and discouragement and suffering is nothing compared to this joyful weight of who we are as children of God. And the weight of the glory of God and all eternity brings hope, light, joy, and peace into our lives. And Paul also wants to share with us a definition of faith in this specific reading. And he is referring to faith in verse 18 when he says that we should have our gaze on the things that cannot be seen. We need to fix our gaze on these things. And the Greek word for fix means to look intently, to concentrate, almost like looking through a microscope or a telescope to things that is invisible for the naked eye. And fixing our eyes and fixing our gaze on the things that cannot be seen is looking at life and looking at our circumstances through the telescope and the microscope of the resurrected Christ, so that we can see the unseen God in the seen Son of God, Jesus Christ. And what is it that we see here this morning? We see wine and we see bread. And these are the symbols of the suffering of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that benefits humanity. Paul's life was like a book, and Paul was able to actually jump inside of this book to the end of the book, although he was still living in the middle of this book. And this book was reminding him of his life, how it unfolds. But Paul also knew how this book would end and where it will end. It will end in God's eternal presence, in God's amazing grace. For those of us tuned into this service this morning that feel that my life is kind of a chapter at this present moment, where I experience a lot of trouble, a lot of discouragement, a lot of pain and suffering, may we experience that God's Word wants to guide us in these difficult and trying circumstances. And may it be true for you as well, that you will be able to say with the psalmist, I believe in God, and now I speak. Amen. I would like to invite you this morning to the table of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and I would also like to thank Judy and Tony that prepared this table and the elements for us this morning. And I would just like to share a few thoughts with you. Beloved in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, attend to the words of the institution of the Holy Supper of Jesus. These words are delivered by the Apostle Paul, for I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a piece of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took a cup, and he said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. For the proper celebration of the Lord's Supper, genuine self-examination is needed. And let us examine ourselves this morning in the light of Jesus' summary of God's law, as we find it in Matthew chapter 22, when the Pharisees and the Sadducees came to Jesus and asked him, So, Master, what is the most important law in God's law? And Jesus answered, You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. Let's take a moment and reflect on my love for God and my love for my neighbor. Let's join in a prayer of confession. God of endless possibility, you fill our lives with purpose despite the troubles we many a time encounter. We confess we so often prefer to follow our own ways. We resist your wisdom and think we know better. Forgive our stubborn nature. By the power of your Holy Spirit and the grace of Christ our Lord, give us a teachable spirit, so we will constantly return to the ways you teach us. Amen. As our assurance of pardon this morning, just a very short sentence from a wonderful psalm, Psalm 18, verse 28. Lord, it is you who light my lamp. The Lord my God lights up my darkness. Let's profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, and suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Dear family and friends, we are here at the Lord's table. Let's join together in prayer. Lord Jesus, we come to this table remembering your works of salvation in our lives. You have saved us from sin and death. You have brought us together to worship you and to thank you for all that you've done. We remember how you gave your life, how you fell to the ground like a grain of wheat and died, and how you called out, "My God, my God, why did you abandon me?" So that we might nevermore be forsaken by God. And now we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Amen. Dear family, the bread which we break is our communion with the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Take, eat, remember, and believe that his body was broken as a complete remission for all our sins. The body of Christ. Dear family, the cup of blessing is our communion with the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Take this cup, drink, and believe that the precious blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was shed as a complete remission for all our sins. The blood of Christ. Let's join together in prayer. We thank you, loving God, for the wonderful opportunity we have to place ourselves and those whom we love and our world in your hands. And we can do this with confidence, knowing that you hear our prayers and that you are with us every step of the way. We pray for those who serve our nation as leaders. May they be sensitive to the impact of their decisions on all people, especially in these days with what unfolded in Kamloops this past week. We pray for your church here and around the world. We pray for the commissioners of General Assembly starting their meeting today. Give them grace in their considerations, love in their speech, wisdom in their deliberations, and kindness in all things. We bring to you our doctors and our nurses in our hospitals and all the staff involved in treating the sick. We also pray for our vaccine centers and everybody working there. We bring to you our young parents and their children and our students in this time of COVID. Hear our prayers for the sick of the world and also those in our congregation. We bring to you John and Lois and Chris. Hear us when we pray the words Jesus taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Our concluding hymn this morning is hymn 563.
To learn to
And now, dear family and friends, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship with the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.